scalar potential of magnetic field. We have already seen that the electric field can be represented as minus the gradient of the potential, or the electric potential minus gradient V. So we can say that E equal minus gradient V. In a similar way, we can say that the magnetic field H equal minus gradient the magnetic potential Vm. And because effectively the magnetic field can be represented as scalar potential Vm and another potential, which would be vector potential, so we are saying that Vm is the scalar potential of magnetic field. For the case of the electric field, we have only scalar potential. So we didn't say that the scalar potential of electric field. We said potential of electric field. So in this case, assuming that the magnetic field is presented as minus the gradient of the scalar potential of the magnetic field, so curl H equal J, which is Ampere's law, in this case, H can be replaced by minus grad V, M. And from the mathematics of the curl operation and the gradient, it is known that the curl of any gradient is zero. So, effectively, this presentation for the magnetic field is valid only at any region where J equals zero. So, the representation of the magnetic field in terms of the scalar magnetic potential is valid only in any space where the current density J equals zero. Effectively, this presentation is quite important in solving the problems of machines like motors, generators, and transformers. So, the scalar magnetic potential is basically used for solving machine problems. Now, we said that the relation between the magnetic flux and the magnetic field is B equals mu H. And we know from Gauss law for the magnetic field that the divergence of the magnetic flux density is always zero. So we can say that mu naught divergence of H equals zero. And if we are going to represent H as minus grad V, we can obtain Laplace equation for the magnetic field as mu naught divergence of minus grad Vm equals zero, or in other words, nabla squared Vm equals zero when the current density J equals zero. So in this case, the scalar magnetic potential is governed by Laplace equation. Following similar steps for solving Laplace equation, we can do it for the case of magnetic field problem. As an example, if we have such coaxial structure where the magnetic field is H phi equals I over 2 by rho, and rho is greater than A and less than B, so the magnetic field here is in phi direction. We can represent this magnetic field in terms of a scalar magnetic potential as minus grad Vm. And because we have only phi component for the magnetic field, so we have only the phi component of this gradient operator. So in this case, H phi would equal minus 1 over rho the derivative of Vm with respect to phi, which is the phi component of the gradient, because we don't have any other components. So this means that I over 2 by rho, which is HFI, equals minus 1 over rho, the derivative of Vm with respect to phi. By eliminating this rho with this rho, we say that the derivative of the magnetic potential, or the magnetic scalar potential Vm with respect to phi, would equal minus I over 2 pi. By integrating both sides, we can say that the magnetic scalar potential for the case of the coaxial structure would be I over 2 pi multiplied by phi with a negative sign. And phi here is from minus phi to pi. So this is the magnetic scalar potential inside a coaxial structure. Effectively, as I said, this magnetic scalar potential would be quite useful for solving the problem of the machines. And we have in the following chapter some examples based on this magnetic scalar potential, which we are calling magnetic circuits. So until going to the magnetic circuits, we will be satisfied with just the definition of this magnetic scalar potential. Okay. All right. Now, by taking the property of Gauss law for the magnetic field, such that the divergence of B is always zero, and from the properties of the curl operation, such that the divergence of any curl of any vector is always zero, so we can say that the magnetic flux density is actually a curl of some vector, and this vector we are going to assume it as A, and we are going to call this A as the magnetic vector potential. So effectively, this is coming from the probability that the divergence of any rotation, or the divergence of any curl for any vector, equals zero. So this means that B should be a curl of a vector such that the divergence of B is always zero. And because B equals mu naught H, so we can say that the magnetic field H is 1 over mu naught curl A. And from Gauss law, we know that curl H equals J. So in this case, 1 over mu naught curl A would equal J. So this actually is the relation between the magnetic vector potential and the current density J. The curl-curl operator can be simplified as nabla dot A minus nabla squared A. And it should be noted that this cannot be simplified as nabla squared. Here, we are going to take the divergence of A such that the derivative of Ax with respect to X plus the derivative of Ay with respect to Y, plus the derivative of Az with respect to Z. And after taking the divergence, all this value will be derived with respect to X in X direction. Then it would be derived with respect to Y in Y direction, and then would be derived with respect to Z in Z direction. But nabla squared A, it means that the derivative with respect to 2x squared for ax and ay and az plus the derivative with respect to y squared for ay for ax and ay and az plus the derivative with respect to z squared for ax plus ay plus az. So this term is not this term. Alright? Okay. So effectively, the relation between the magnetic flux or sorry, the magnetic vector potential A and the current J can be represented in this form according to 1 over mu naught curl curl A, which can be simplified as 1 over mu naught nabla nabla dot A minus nabla squared A equals J. Now, until now, we said that B is curl A. Did we introduce any condition for this A? No, actually no. Any vector, we have taken its curl, so its divergence it would be zero. So there is no condition at all on this vector A. Alright. So to simplify this problem, let us apply a condition for A. So this new condition will not affect the main property that the divergence of curl A would be zero. So the condition that what we are going to assume is nabla dot A equals zero. So assuming that nabla dot A equals zero, so this form can be simplified as 1 over mu naught multiplied by minus nabla squared A would equal J. Or in other words, nabla squared A would equal minus mu naught J. So the only condition that we have assumed till now is the divergence of the magnetic vector potential is zero. And this is our assumption. And this assumption does not affect on the fact that the divergence of curl A equals zero. Okay? So, now we have the magnetic vector potential, nabla squared A equal minus mu naught J. Alright. So, what's the advantage of this magnetic vector potential? If we look at this vector relation, we find that nabla squared is a scalar operator. It is not a vector operator. It is the derivative with respect to x squared plus the derivative with respect to y squared plus the derivative with respect to z squared and without any vectors. So this scalar operator operating on a vector quantity equal a scalar quantity minus mu multiplied by a vector quantity. So, in other words, we can say that the x component here equals the x component here, the y component here equals the y component here, the z component here would equal the z component here. So, this equation can be separated into three equations. One for the x component, one for the y component, and one for the z component. And each component by itself is a scalar quantity. So, we converted the vector operation here to three scalar quantities or three scalar operations. And the magnetic vector potential in x direction depends only on the current in x direction. Also, the magnetic vector potential in y direction depends only on the magnetic current density in y direction. Finally, the magnetic vector potential in z direction depends only on the current density in z direction. So, we can solve this problem as a scalar problem. Similarly, we can solve this problem as a scalar problem. Similarly, we can solve this problem as a scalar problem. Then, by adding ax in x direction plus ay in y direction plus az in z direction, we can obtain the magnetic vector potential, the vector A. Effectively, this advantage is not obtained directly in the Ampere's law, because in Ampere's law, we say that the rotation or curl H equals J. Here, Jx depends on Hy and Hz, and Jy depends on Hx and Hz, and Jz depends on Hx and Hy. So, there is a combination between magnetic field components to find another component for the current density. But in the magnetic vector potential, the x component is directly related to the X component of the magnetic of the current density. The Y component of the magnetic vector potential is directly related to the Y component of the electric current density in Y direction, and so on. So the magnetic vector potential has an advantage on the magnetic field directly, that the magnetic vector potential is directly related to the current. So the X component related to X component, the Y component related to the Y component, the Z component related to the Z component. So if I have current distribution, it is preferred to find the magnetic vector potential first, because I'm solving X with respect to X, Y with respect to Y, Z with respect to Z. And then after obtaining the three components of the magnetic vector potential, now I have the complete magnetic vector potential. Now by applying the magnetic vector potential in this scalar operator, I can obtain the magnetic field. Okay? Alright. From electrostatics, we know that the Laplacian operator for the electric potential nabla squared V was equal minus rho V over epsilon naught. And effectively, from Coulomb's law and the potential due to a volume of charge distribution and so on, we already proved that the potential V is the integration over the volume rho V dV over 4 by epsilon R. Please return to the chapter of the electric potential to see the potential from a point of charge. So then the potential from distributed charge, you will find the potential from distributed charge like this. So effectively, we can say that the solution of this differential equation, nabla squared V equal minus rho V over epsilon, it can be presented as V is the integration over the volume, rho V over epsilon, multiplied by dV over 4 by R. Okay? And here, the negative signs disappear. So, as we multiply by negative, so negative, it would be positive. In a similar way, we can say that nabla squared Ax, which was equal minus mu naught Gx. So we can say by analogy, Ax, it can be found as the integration over the volume. Here it was rho V over epsilon. Rho V over epsilon. Here it is mu naught Gx. So it would be mu naught Gx, multiplied by dV over 4 by R. dV over 4 by R. So, if I know the differential equation of the magnetic vector potential, I can find out the magnetic vector potential in terms of its current, as Ax would be the integration over the volume mu naught Gx dV over 4 by R. Similarly, we can say, or we can obtain Ay and Az. So, in general, we can say that the magnetic vector potential A in terms of the current density J equals the integration over the volume mu naught J dV over 4 by R. So, this is a relation between the magnetic vector potential and its corresponding current density J. Now, if I obtain the magnetic vector potential, which is 1 to 1 with respect to the X, X to X, Y to Y, Z to Z. Once I obtain the magnetic vector potential, by getting the curl of the magnetic vector potential, I can obtain the magnetic flux density B. And from the magnetic flux density B, I can obtain the magnetic field H as 1 over mu naught curl A. Okay. Effectively, this magnetic vector potential is quite important in the problems of antennas. So, when we are going to drive the radiation from the antenna, at the beginning, we are going to drive the magnetic vector potential from the current of the antenna, and after getting the magnetic vector potential, we will obtain the magnetic field and the electric field. So this magnetic vector potential play a very important role in the problem of the antenna. And previously I mentioned that the scalar magnetic potential plays a very important role in the problems of electric machine. Okay? Alright. This magnetic vector potential was derived for current density J with respect to the volume. What will be the situation if I'm talking about surface current K? So instead of integration with respect to volume, it would be integration with respect to the surface. So the magnetic vector potential for surface current density K would be the integration over the surface mu naught K ds over 4 pi r. If I'm talking about current filament L with length L, so the magnetic vector potential would be mu naught idl over 4 pi r. And in all cases, the magnetic field is obtained as the curl of the magnetic vector potential. Alright? Okay.